Hi, welcome at the 22nd Workplace Ninjas User Group Netherlands Tuesday's webinar. Today we have Dirk-Jan Mollema, who's going to present on security. And security is very important nowadays. His session is called Azure, Conditional Access, Attackers, and You, the Present, the Future of Attacks Against the Microsoft Cloud. Very interesting if you ask me. But first, let's thank our sponsors. Without our sponsors, we're not able to organize events like this. And hopefully we will be back on premises with in-person events very soon. If you don't follow us, please follow us on Twitter, Meetup, Facebook, YouTube, and LinkedIn. And if you tweet, use the hashtag WPNinjasNL so we can also keep track on that. In the next couple of weeks, we have some awesome new events lined up. The 13th of April, Greg Ramsey will join us. And Greg is a longtime MVP in enterprise mobility space. And he will present a session about automation and the workplace. The 20th of April, Ronnie and Franz will have their Ask Me Anything Live podcast recording again. Be sure to join it, and if you have questions for David, make sure to submit them. And the 27th of April, our own Peter will join us. If you want to talk also at our user group, if you have an interesting subject, don't hesitate to contact us or just submit your session, and maybe you will be one of the next speakers of this event. But now let's hand it over to Dirk-Jan Mollema.
As long as that's viable for them. However, if you have a very fancy bike, for example, an electric bike that costs over €1,000, then you might need a few more locks. Otherwise, your bike still will get stolen because it has a lot of value for attackers. And that's also a bit true for your cloud environment. If you're, for example, a big bank with a lot of money and a lot of value for attackers to gain, then you may need to secure your cloud environment more than just a small business that maybe has 10 people working for it. So it's a bit similar to that. And multi-factor authentication in this case is just the equivalent of a lock on a bike. So it's just one lock. And if you have a very fancy bike, then only MFA won't be enough to secure it. So a bit of translation. How does this compare to a bike? If we look at the public cloud attacks, then password spraying is very low cost for them because it's easy. It can be done anonymously from the internet. And if you have one hit, you can just focus on that cloud, and after you can move on to something else. If you have multi-factor authentication, then for an attacker, this means extra cost or extra effort in their attacks. So as long as there are organizations without multi-factor authentication, then the attackers will likely focus on these organizations, and they're less likely to focus on organizations that have MFA required for everyone. So having said that, I think multi-factor authentication is only one part of the protection. Right now, it still may be enough to protect you against most of the attacks because most of the attacks are still quite low effort. But let's not forget that attackers can also phish multi-factor authentication in some cases. And eventually, or actually probably already, a lot of attacks will evolve beyond simply spraying credentials, and then multi-factor authentication won't be sufficient anymore to protect your cloud environment. Does it mean that you shouldn't use it? No, absolutely not. You should enable it, and especially for sensitive accounts, but don't think that it's the magic solution for all of your problems. And as long as you have multi-factor authentication, that you're safe. And that's something you will also see in this talk. So let's talk a bit about how to set multi-factor authentication, because there's an important difference here. So the first way, which is the classic way, which is the, basically the pre-conditional access way. That's per-user multi-factor authentication. And you set that in a different portal, and it's really a binary switch. Either you have it enforced, or you have it disabled. And if you have it enforced, then every sign in, whichever application you're authenticating to, you will need to enter MFA. You have the option to accept certain IP ranges, such as the IP ranges of your internal network, but that's basically it. Alternatively, you also have conditional access MFA, which is the more modern approach, and then you can enforce MFA based on conditions. So you can require it only for certain users or only for certain sensitive applications. So per user MFA is set in this portal, the MFA portal. It's not the prettiest portal, but basically here you can set multi-factor authentication for a user, and you see that for this user that the multi-factor authentication is enforced. Now, an interesting thing with this is that as an attacker, I can see which users have this MFA enforced. For this portal here, I actually need administrator permissions to see who has this enforced. And as a regular user, I can't access that. But there are some artifacts that are created whenever you enforce MFA this way for a user. So the user will be assigned the Active Authentication Administrator role on the Microsoft Azure Active Authentication application. And well, this role doesn't actually give you any permissions, but it's just that whenever you enable per user MFA for a user, then they somehow get this role, and everyone in the Azure AD can query this information. So on this screen, you see the Rode Recon tool, which is a tool that I wrote to analyze Azure AD environments. And if you see the application roles tab, you can query for this, and thus you can see who has per user MFA enforced. And you can see this as any user, so you don't need admin privileges for this. So the short version, if you enforce MFA this way for a user, they get the Active Authentication Administrator role. I'm not sure why this happens. It doesn't give you any special privileges. And if you manually remove this role, it also doesn't remove the requirement to use MFA. So I don't know why this is, but it's just some side effect, I think, of applying this. But the result is that any user can query this, and any user can just see which users in your organization have per user MFA enforced. Now, if we look at conditional access policies, it works a bit differently. So this is an example of a conditional access policy, and you say which users they apply to, which applications it applies to, and then you set the access control to grant access on the condition that the user uses multi-factor authentication. So this is a completely different way of setting it, and it also allows you to use certain conditions instead of just always requiring it. Now, in this case, the best policy for conditional access is one that applies to all clients. So that means all browsers or desktop clients or mobile applications and all applications. So every Office 365 application, but also other applications connected to your Azure AD. If you set your conditional access policy very broadly, then it's going to be very hard for attackers to bypass this. However, if you start selecting various conditions and create a lot of very fine-grained policies, then there's a big chance that attackers will find a way around those, because it's really tricky to make these policies really work if you start doing these fine-grained settings. So for example, there are some exclusions that you could make to a policy. So you could, for example, say, okay, I don't want this policy to apply to a certain platform, or I don't want to have a requirement for MFA in a certain location, which can be an IP range, for example. And of course, these exclusions mean that if an attacker can somehow comply with that exclusion, then they won't actually hit the conditional access policy, and they may be able to authenticate without using MFA. So one thing to note here is that the device platform is based on user agent. So I'm, for example, creating a conditional access policy, and one of the conditions is the device platform. So in this case, I'm creating a bit of a weird policy, because I'm, instead of selecting any device, I just select all the supported devices. And I say, okay, on all these platforms, access is blocked. And well, I selected all the platforms, which is not really the recommended way of doing it, but you would expect that that blocks access to on all these platforms, which isn't strictly true, but because not all the platforms are supported by conditional access. So for example, if I set my user agent to macOS, then I get the message that I can't log in, because the conditional access policy applies to macOS, and the it says, okay, you can't log in there, so I can't log in that with that from that browser. But if I change that to the default, and this is what's in a Linux VM, so then it's Firefox on Linux, then it suddenly allows it, because Linux is not a supported platform for conditional access, so there's no checkbox for it. And then you'll see that the device platform, which was in this case empty, was not matched, so the policy didn't apply. So if you would be using a policy like this, then attackers could find ways around it simply by changing their user agent in the browser, and they might not need the controls that you set for it. There's also the client apps condition. And in this case, you can say, okay, I want this policy to apply to browsers or to mobile applications or to legacy authentication clients, which honestly is a whole different topic that we won't be getting into. But in this case, this policy only applies to browsers. So if I log in using a browser, then I get the multi-factor authentication prompt, because this was a policy that I set to require multi-factor authentication. However, if I pretend to be the Microsoft Teams desktop app, then I can log in with only a username and password. And in this case, I'm using my Broad Recon tool that I discussed previously, which supports a lot of kind of hackerish sign-ins to really test these policies. And you can see that I used the minus C parameter, which means I'm supplying a custom client. And in this case, that was Microsoft Teams. And because Microsoft Teams is a desktop client, the browser policy doesn't apply to it. So you can still access these things because the policy didn't apply to desktop clients. And in the logging, you see that I logged in using Microsoft Teams. However, with the user agent Python requests, which Teams, of course, doesn't use. So it's, well, quite an obvious sign-in that was not really intended, and that someone pretended to Microsoft Teams, but it's not blocked because it wasn't forbidden by the policy. And using that access token that I obtained, I can use the, for example, the Outlook API to access Office 365 email. And in this case, I can simply select all the messages. So in this case, I can read the email using the API. And I can't go to Outlook in the browser, because then I would be hitting the browser policy. But I can use or I can pretend to be Microsoft Teams, then get a token for the API. And then using the API, I can access the email still. So that's a bit more cumbersome, but there's nothing that prevents me from doing this, because there simply was no policy for desktop applications.
Dirk-Jan, I have a question. Would you be able to also mimic device compliance in this case?
No, so this is only using a username and password. So device compliance doesn't come into play here yet.
Okay, but you are able to mimic it, or not? Say, for example, on a non-compliant device, go somewhere and tell it, hey, I'm compliant as well. Is that an option?
No. Well, we'll get into device compliancy later, and then I'll show you what the requirements are for this. But if you only have a username and password, then you can't pretend you're on a compliant device.
Yeah, the information is also stored in Azure AD.
Yes.
Great, thanks.
And there's some tricks that Azure AD does to see if you're on a compliant device. And if I use this way of signing in, then it doesn't use those tricks. So Azure is not going to see if I'm on a device or not. So if there was a policy that required a compliant device, this would not work. So let's talk about some of the evolving attacks against Azure, because we've seen the previous attacks, and we know that attackers are password spraying a lot. But in December, there were quite some developments in this, and some more advanced attacks were came in the news. So if we look at the kill chain, I'm not sure that you're all familiar with this, but if you look at how a data breach usually happens, then there are different phases. So there's initial foothold, which attackers traditionally get by using phishing, for example. And then in an on-prem scenario, they try to propagate through the network. So they'll do some scanning, and they'll try to dump credentials and then get admin access. And then they will have their action on objectives, and they will try to obtain, for example, sensitive data from a company. So this is how the kill chain looks for a traditional Active Directory on-prem network, for example. Now in Azure, this is a bit different, because there's not a lot of opportunities for lateral movement in Azure, because Azure AD is really identity focused. So it's not like you can use a user account and then log in onto a server somewhere and then dump the credentials from the admin that's on the server, and then you're an admin, and then you're admin on a different server, et cetera, et cetera. That doesn't really exist. So in Azure, everything is confined to the identity that you are. And make your privileges higher, so obtain a higher privileged account in Azure AD, or you want to access the objectives, such as, for example, the email of the CEO, then you have a few options as an attacker. So either you try to use the identity you already have. So you use, for example, a normal employee, and then you send emails in the company pretending that there is some bill that urgently needs to be paid, which is commonly known as CEO fraud. And that only requires you to have access to one account, and you can send email with that account. Otherwise, you could also try to guess passwords, or to use phishing and phish for credentials, and then you phish your way up until you have the account that you want, or the admin account that you want. That might not always be effective, especially if multi-factor authentication is in play. So the last options that attackers have is attacking central components that have privileges over multiple identities. So if there's a central component that can manage a lot of identities, or there's an application that can manage sensitive things, then that's very interesting for attackers to access, because that might be one of the easier ways, or the only way, to actually elevate the privileges in Azure AD. So if we look at the SolarGate compromise, which started with the attack on the SolarWinds company, and the attackers backdoored an update of the SolarWinds project, and with that way they gained access to a lot of company networks. So that was, that was kind of a big deal, because even Microsoft got infected. But what the other interesting thing was, is that they performed their lateral movement in the traditional on-prem Windows Server Active Directory to become domain admin, and then they wanted to move to the cloud, because a lot of sensitive information was actually stored in Office 365. So they weren't only interested in things that were on-prem, but also interested in things that were stored in the cloud. And they actually used on-prem components to access that in the cloud. So what they did is they abused ADFS, and ADFS is used for authentication in Azure AD. It's one of the authentication options. And you see this complex architecture here that when a user tries to access anything in Azure, then they sign in with Azure AD. But because this is a federated domain and the company uses ADFS, then they actually get redirected to some on-prem components, and the on-prem components use Active Directory to actually authenticate the user. So what this means that if this is compromised, this on-prem part, then that also means that anything that goes in here and the whole validation is also compromised. So then Azure AD relies on the on-prem components to perform the authentication. But if your on-prem Active Directory is compromised, then you can also compromise this federation server and just say, okay, anyone, or you can just say that you give tickets to anyone, or you pretend to be anyone, because the federation server that's supposed to do the validation is under your control. So you can send out certain SAML tokens, which basically say that you're an admin in the cloud, and Azure AD will then accept that because it trusts that this federation server is doing its job correctly, which it isn't. And this is all because ADFS is using protocols that are really based on cryptography. So Azure AD and the ADFS component, they exchange certain tokens, and these tokens use signing and encryption to prove that they are valid. So Azure AD trusts ADFS, and ADFS has a certain certificate and a private key that it uses to sign these tokens. And Azure AD then checks if the token signature is correct, that it's issued by that private key, and then it will trust the token. So if your ADFS is compromised and attackers have the private key, then they can create any token, and they can also claim to be any user. And because ADFS also has the opportunity to handle MFA on itself, and it can actually implement MFA from different parties, Azure AD will just trust it when the token says, oh yeah, I've already handled the MFA for you. So if you have compromised this key, you can also bypass MFA because it's just another claim in that ADFS issued token. And if you have the private key, then you can just put anything in the token and then sign it correctly. So this is known as the golden SAML attack. And then there are some tools made public by FireEye that you can use as an attacker to dump the certificate and private key from ADFS, and with that you can create your own tokens. And another downside of ADFS actually is that it's much easier to do password sprays against ADFS than it is to do it against Azure AD. That's a bit a side note. So what can we learn from this? Attackers will focus on the least resistant parts. They will steal the bike with the fewest locks. And if you have critical apps in Azure AD, then they will look at the easiest way to compromise your Azure AD. And that could be your on-prem environment. So in this case, the on-prem Active Directory becomes the weak link to your whole cloud environment. And if you're using something like ADFS, then it by definition, it means that the on-prem handles the whole identity part. So if you put all your trust in these on-prem components, it also means that if your on-prem infrastructure is compromised, then your cloud infrastructure is also compromised. That's something that I don't think a lot of people realize, but it's kind of how it was designed. Is this scenario clear for everyone with the whole attack and the SolarWinds stuff?
Yes.
All right, good. If there are questions, then just shoot them my way, right? So this was the lateral movement, and now the attacker wants to perform action on objectives. So they want to actually get access to all that sensitive data. And one of the ways would be to log in with each single user, assuming they compromised everyone's credentials. But that's not really, it scales bad, and different users may have, for example, MFA requirements, and they would need to fake tokens for everyone. So that's, it's doable, but it's quite a lot of work. And if they start assigning delegated permissions on mailboxes, then there's likely an alarm going off somewhere, because this is quite monitored nowadays, at least by most of the Microsoft products. So what these attackers realize, eventually everything that you access in Office 365, whether that's email, whether that's SharePoint, it's usually everything is an API. So the whole, all the web interfaces under the hood, they all use the same APIs, such as Microsoft Graph or the Outlook Graph, to access the actual content of the messages. So if you are a global admin, you can easily assign yourself or an application that you control permissions to use these APIs and to query everyone's emails. And if you do that, then it's much easier to read everyone's emails, because it's a permission that you can assign to an application, and then you can do it in bulk just for every user. And it's also much faster, because, well, APIs are designed to be fast. So this was what came out in January, and then Malwarebytes was hacked, and they suggested abuse of privileged access to Microsoft 365. And this was interesting, especially for me, because they actually linked back to a blog that I wrote in 2019 about elevating privileges in Azure AD through applications. And because there are a lot of applications that have, for example, these permissions to read email, if there is already an application which has these permissions, then the attacker can simply take over that application by assigning credentials to it. And in the Malwarebytes case, they just added a certificate to an existing application, which was allowed to access things in Office 365. And via that way, they dumped all that data. And this is really tricky to find, because the Azure portal doesn't even show credentials that you assign to service principals. And it's really impossible to see that. And I don't think anyone is even monitoring for it. There are now, after these attacks, some queries were made public, but this was already something that was publicly known since I blogged about it in 2019. So the knowledge was there, but because no one was abusing it yet, no one was monitoring for it. And actually, it turned out that some threat actors were already using it, because no one was monitoring for it. So there are other on-prem components, because we talked about ADFS so far, but ADFS is only one of the ways to connect your on-prem to the cloud. And something that's almost always present is Azure AD Connect to synchronize the users that you have on-prem into Azure AD, and sometimes the other way around as well. And if you have if you use password hash synchronization, then it also synchronizes the password hashes into Azure AD, so that you can sign in with the password both in on-prem and in the cloud. And of course, the Azure AD Connect is a very sensitive component here, because it can access all the password hashes in the on-prem Active Directory, but also because it has very high privileges in Azure Active Directory. And actually, it turns out that the sync account in Azure AD can manage all applications. And of course, the credentials for this sync account are stored in the on-prem database of Azure AD Connect. And because this AD Connect is something that's always there, because in almost every scenario where you want to synchronize on-prem with the cloud, you will need Azure AD Connect. That makes it quite easy to move from on-prem access to Azure AD access, because via these applications or via these service principles, you could access a lot of interesting data via the APIs. And if you're using, for example, managed identities in Azure Resource Manager, these are also service principles. So any managed identity that you give access to data in Azure Resource Manager, or that you give access in your Azure AD, they can be managed by the Azure AD Connect Sync account. So if someone has that Azure AD Connect Sync account, they can assign new credentials to these managed identities or to these service principles, same thing, and then they can access all the information via the APIs. And it's also not, I've seen it quite often that service principles have, for example, a global admin permissions for some migration or something, or that they have high permissions on a subscription, which means these are quite sensitive accounts. But because they're not user accounts, they are not subject to conditional access policies. So the takeaway of this, if you're really cloud focused, then your on-prem may be a weak component, and advanced attackers may attack actually your on-prem, where there's likely to be a lot more security vulnerabilities than only your cloud in your cloud infrastructure. The AD Connect server is really important, protected like it's a domain controller. It actually has the same privileges as a domain controller in some cases, so that's also very important. And service principles don't have conditional access. They don't have MFA. So if you use service principles somewhere in an application and that application has high privileges, make sure to protect that really well. And I guess the last takeaway is that real world threat actors do read blogs. And if there's some security thing in the news that even no one may be using today, you don't know if that will still be the case tomorrow. And in this case, I think that, especially in the SolarWinds campaign, that we've seen some things that were not abused yet by red teams a lot, because most of them don't focus really much on Azure AD yet, is my experience. And in this case, the threat actors were definitely ahead of the techniques that were used. And I also think Microsoft was quite surprised to see these, well, sort of more advanced, exotic scenarios that, well, they weren't really offering any monitoring for. Any questions about this part? I'll take the silence as a no.
No questions.
No questions.
All right, so back to conditional access policies. How can you actually enumerate those policies? Of course, as an administrator, you can see the access policies in the Azure portal, but an attacker usually doesn't start with administrator privileges, so they can't really see the policies. But attackers can find out the policies in different ways. So for example, they can simply try. So in this case, I'm using a tool called MFA Sweep, and it uses different ways of authenticating. So it tries to authenticate, for example, using the portal, but also using various APIs. And then you can see if a policy is blocking that, or if MFA is required or not, and if there's any way to access information that doesn't require MFA, then an attacker is of course likely to use that. And this also uses the Active Sync, which is a legacy authentication protocol. So if you don't have those disabled and you do have policies for other protocols, then attackers could still access email using Active Sync, for example. If you have access as an attacker, if you already have credentials or you phish someone with access, then you can actually collect all the policies, even as a limited user. And in RootRecon, there's also a plugin to pass them. So in this case, it will produce a nice table with all the policies that are there in the environment. And it will say, it will basically offer a nice overview of all the policies. For example, this. So these are a few policies that I have in my test environment. And I personally find this overview sometimes a bit easier to digest than the Microsoft portal, because in the Microsoft portal you have to click 20 million times to get through all the policies and see what controls there are, and it just gives it in a nice table. So even for system administrators, this is I think quite a useful feature. And of course for attackers it's also useful, because with any account in Azure AD you can query this, and you can find ways around these policies. So I think the most important takeaway here is that any condition access policies that you set are not a secret. Anyone with an account can query them and see which policies are in place, and that this also applies for per user MFA. So they can very easily see which of your admin accounts don't have per user MFA enabled, or which accounts are not subject to policies, or which platforms are not subject to policies. So it's important to have a good condition access policy strategy, because any holes are easily identified by anyone with an account.
Dirk-Jan, question. What about guest accounts? Does they also have some access to that, or is that completely built in disabled?
For guest accounts, by default, they can't query this. From the top of my head, you have to. There are settings for guest accounts, and if you treat your guest accounts like regular users, then they can query this. But otherwise, you have to give them the directory reader's role explicitly, I think. And the users in your own tenant will by default have that role, but guests don't.
Okay, thanks.
So normally a guest cannot do this, but it's best to test. All right. So let's talk about primary refresh tokens, which is a very interesting concept. So in this case, we're gonna look a bit forward, because this is I think this is already being abused by threat actors, but it's not something that you hear about a lot yet. But let's assume all the condition access policies are perfect, and multi-factor authentication is required everywhere, and phishing with MFA, let's ignore that. And there are also legacy authentication is disabled, and there are no weird exceptions that attackers can easily bypass. So it's a very locked down, strict environment. So what will attackers do then? Then it kind of comes back to the endpoint. So endpoint being a mobile device or a laptop. And there are a lot of scenarios in Azure AD, and you have hybrid joins where they are joined to both on-prem and Azure AD. They can be only joined to Azure AD and, for example, managed by Intune, or they can be registered in Azure AD, which is usually used for personal devices. And in all these scenarios, a user usually doesn't want to enter credentials all the time, because if you're using Office 65 on your work on your laptop, you're not gonna enter your multi-factor authentication every 5 minutes, or you're not gonna re-enter your password every time that you start your laptop. So this is where single sign-on comes into play. because Microsoft wanted to make a way that users can sign into their laptop, and that doesn't necessarily have to be with a password. It can also be with Windows Hello, for example. And then they still can access their account in Azure and all their information in Office 365. And that's where primary refresh tokens are used. So how do primary refresh tokens work? In this case, if a device is joined or registered in Azure AD, there's kind of a cryptographic trust established. It usually means that the device gets a certificate and a private key, and Azure AD trusts that certificate. So the device can create a signature of some kind, and then it proves that it has that certificate and private key. And then Azure AD knows that it's that device. And then it can see, oh, is this device compliant, for example? And then Azure AD knows that the user is actually on that device. And having this cryptographic trust allows Azure AD to exchange tokens. And these are, they're kind of long-lived single sign-on tokens called primary refresh token. And with the primary refresh token, you can sign in to any application as that user, even including sometimes MFA claims, because these are also stored in the token. And the documentation says that these primary refresh tokens are valid for 2 weeks. However, in practice, they are valid for 90 days. So a laptop that has, for example, Windows Hello, has a primary refresh token, and it can use single sign-on to Azure AD for up to 90 days without requiring the user to re-enter their password or MFA. Of course, these tokens are quite sensitive. So if the laptop has a Trusted Platform Module, or TPM, which is a special chip that enables hardware cryptography, then the private key for this certificate, but also the key for the primary refresh token, they are stored in this TPM. So how does this actually work? Any application that's running on in the user session, so on the user's desktop, can request single sign-on data. So any application that wants to sign the user in to something that's Azure AD joined, they can do that. And that works via some remote procedure calls or via some helper applications. For example, Chrome has a plugin to have single sign-on in Azure AD. And that plugin actually calls an executable that's on disk, and then that application will query LSS, which is the security process running in Windows, and LSS will give it a cookie which Chrome can use to single sign-on for that user. So there's quite some material reading into this, but basically if something is running on your desktop of your Azure AD joint device, then that program can single sign-on into Azure AD as being that user. That's the short version. And if you want to read the long version, there's two links here about one from me and one from a different researcher who was researching this at the same time, about how that works on a technical level. And I just wanted to give a demo for this, because I think it's enough slides for now, unless there's a question in between.
No questions yet.
Good. All right, so I have two virtual machines here. On the left is my Linux virtual machine, and that's an attacker virtual machine, so that's where I do my hacking. And on the right is a hybrid joint Windows 10 virtual machine that I need to sign into. And hope that it works. It's a great thing with doing live demos. All right, so in this example, I'm going to use some of my tools. So this is RoadTools. And with RoadTools, I can perform a single sign-on into Azure using some program that's also running on this this victim virtual machine, so to say. So the scenario is that I've compromised this computer somehow, and for example, via phishing with malware, and that I can run any program that I want. So then I want to do some single sign-on, and then I run RoadRecon. And I initialize the single sign-on process. So what this does, it connects to the Microsoft website, and it says, hey, I want to sign in using single sign-on. And that then Microsoft will give me a nonce, which is a one-time value, which needs to be passed to the process securing the primary refresh token. And then using that nonce, I can get a cookie that can use single sign-on to sign me into Azure AD. So a bit confusing, but basically I run this program here called RoadToken, which is a program that I wrote that will call the required procedures for the single sign-on, and I give it that nonce. And then it will give me basically this cookie. So this is a cookie that I can use to sign in to Azure AD. And I pass that cookie back to the attacker machine. And I think it's this one. And then I use this cookie to sign in as that user. And I know it was successful because it says the tokens were written to disk. So in this, now I have access tokens for Azure AD. And with that, I can do whatever I want as that user. So to demo that, let's just run the information gathering script. So now it's gathering all the information that it can find in Azure AD. And that that also works as a regular user. So this is just to show how much information is there. And now I'm starting the GUI, and that one runs in the browser. So just going to slightly make this one larger. So here you see the information that it gathered. So this is not a very large tenant, so there's only 17 users in it. But for each of the users, I can query all their information. And if you have a very large company and you have hundreds of thousands of users, any user can also dump all this information, and they can see all the information that's available. So for a user, they can see the email, but also the mobile phone, which department they work in. They can query all the groups, everyone who's a member of which group, and also all the admins that are present in the directory. And in some cases, you can also see whether they have MFA enabled. So in this case, I think I run the collection with a privileged user. So I'm seeing the MFA information. But even if I didn't do that, I would be able to see which users have per user MFA enabled, because that can be queried from these application roles, as I said earlier. So here you see that this user has the per user MFA enabled. And I can also run the policies plugin, and then it will write it to the to HTML file. And you will see all the conditional access policies. And this I collected with just this regular user, which doesn't have any special permissions.
Okay, it looks like it's like you have on-prem, the on-prem LDAP query issues all over again in the Azure AD.
Yes.
Is there also in the LDAP you can mitigate it somehow? Is there also some mitigation tips you have, or is just by design it's not solvable at the moment?
It's partially solvable. I know that using one of the I think it's the MS Online PowerShell module, you can actually block this. But that's only for the so you can block users from enumerating all the other users and groups. But I'm not sure if that will fully block it or if that only will block the specific APIs that I'm using. And also the fact that this is not something that's available as an option in the portal, or that it's something that's very widely recommended by Microsoft, makes me think that this is not really something they actually want you to use. But it's there as part of the legacy MS Online PowerShell module.
Oh,
so
okay.
I will. I don't know which option it is exactly, but there is an option that you can restrict it. But I'm not sure if it can't be bypassed. I haven't looked at it because I've never seen anyone running with that option actually.
And this was for a user within the Azure AD tenant.
Yes.
What kind of rights or what can a guest user do in a tenant? Is that similar?
So a guest user cannot run this data collection. They will get access denied unless you misconfigured your guest access, or you gave the guests permissions to do this.
Yeah, because there's an option in Azure AD where you can actually further restrict what a guest user can see, but that's that doesn't matter in this case that you just explained.
I know that by default, guests cannot run this data collection.
Ah, okay, yeah.
So unless you make it less strict, then I think it's not possible for guests to do this.
There's a question from Steve Ernu. Could you use attack surface reduction rules to block out unauthorized access to LSAS process like from Unicats to prevent obtaining the token?
So this doesn't actually access LSAS in that way. Later on, we will see something that would be blocked by that rule. But this is simply, so this executable actually only calls a different executable on disk, and it's identical how Google Chrome does it. So if you can use single sign-on with Google Chrome, then you can also do it with this application. So this is not going to be blocked by attack surface reduction rules.
And no admin privileges on the local box is needed.
No, this can be done from a low privilege context. Because it's just like an Active Directory. If you visit an on-prem site in Edge, for example, or God forbid Internet Explorer, then it will also do single sign-on using Kerberos or NTLM. And that's a bit similar. So it will automatically sign you into anything Azure AD if you use Edge or if you use Chrome with the plugin. And this is just calling the exact same a remote procedure call, or in this case, the exact same executable that Chrome also uses to just do the same. It's intended that way.
Okay, thank you.
Let's go back to the slides. One second. To find back the slide where we were. Yes. So let's talk a bit about more advanced condition access policies. And one of the things here is device state. So if you have a condition access policy, you can require a compliant or a hybrid join device. And in this case, a compliant device means that it's managed by Intune. Can be a Windows 10 device or a mobile device or a macOS device, I think. And also that it's in line with the Intune policies. So if you set policies in Intune regarding all kinds of security measures that a client needs to comply with, or that it needs to install latest updates, for example, then this, whether a device is compliant or not, will be decided by Intune. And Intune will store that data in Azure AD. And then whenever you sign in using that device, then Azure AD will look up, oh, is this device still compliant? And then it will pass this condition access policy, or it won't if your device is not compliant or you're not actually on a device that's managed. You also have hybrid joins, and in that case, there's no specific compliancy requirement. It only required that the device is joined to Active Directory and Azure AD at the same time, but it's fully managed by by, for example, GPOs that are stored in AD. So Azure AD doesn't check anything here regarding what's on the device, only that it is a device that is present in Active Directory and also joined to Azure AD. And if you use this single sign-on magic that I just showed, then it will pass these device policies. Because as you see here, the device state in this case is hybrid Azure AD joined. And the device that I did the single sign-on on, it is hybrid Azure AD joined, that's correct. So it doesn't matter that I kind of extracted that token to somewhere else, because that's not checked. It's only checked that the token has the single sign-on token has this this claim that it's on a hybrid Azure AD joint device, and anywhere that I use this single sign-on token to sign in, Azure AD will think I'm on that device. And using this, I can actually obtain, for example, persistent access to email. So what I can do is I can do single sign-on once, and then I get a access token and a refresh token. And the refresh token, both these tokens also have a line in them that says, okay, it's from a hybrid joint device. And with those, I can access the email for, I think, up to 90 days, and I can even refresh the refresh token. So I only need to single sign on once in order to access the email from a completely different device for a very long time. So even if I would lose access as an attacker to the virtual machine or to the victim machine, I can still use these tokens that I used by signing in once to kind of keep my access. And so the primary refresh token is tied to a device, and it's also device state. So compliancy will also come into play if that's a requirement. So if you disable the device, then the primary refresh token is disabled. So you can't do single sign-on anymore from that device. But any refresh tokens that were already given out. So if I requested a refresh token using single sign-on, then I can keep using that refresh token, even though the primary refresh token that was originally used to request it is blocked. Unless I run into a policy that requires either a compliant or hybrid device, then it will look again at the state of the device. And then it will say, hey, but this token originated from this primary refresh token. And does it mean that this is disabled and you cannot do this? But the important thing here is that just disabling a device doesn't necessarily mean that all the access tokens that were issued on that device are immediately invalidated as well.
Dirk, another question. Last month, I think, Microsoft introduced a new feature, continuous access evaluation. How does that compare to the refresh token thing if you compromise it? Does it have relation or am I on the wrong page?
Yeah, I get that question quite often, but from what I've seen with the condition, the continuous access evaluation, that's something that has to be specifically done by the client. So the client being, for example, the Outlook desktop application, that's something that implements the continued access evaluation, and that is what ultimately decides to see if the device is no longer compliant, it will stop working. But it's not something that's enforced actually on the Azure AD side. So there's no requirement to use these continuous evaluations for certain applications or certain tokens. Maybe they'll add it in the future, but at the moment it's not not related. It's just an option that a client can choose to implement or support.
Okay, thank you.
So one final thing to note with these refresh tokens is if you refresh a refresh token, then it will re-evaluate the access policies. So if I have a token that doesn't have multi-factor authentication because I was on a network that didn't need multi-factor authentication, then if I request a new token from a different IP, then I may run into a different access policy that does require MFA, so then it will deny me, for example. So if you have policies for different networks, then as an attacker, you may still need access to that network in order to actually maintain your access. So it's not just you steal a token and you ride off into the desert and you can access something forever. You can actually have policies that also require specific networks or countries for that matter. So a few practical tips in case of a device breach. Of course, change the user password, but also disable the device in Azure AD and reinstall the device and make sure to revoke all the existing refresh tokens. You can do this in the Azure portal, but you can also do that using PowerShell. And if you do that, then any refresh tokens that were issued before a specific date will automatically be refused by Azure AD. So then you know that any stolen tokens will be invalidated as well. So that's an important step to do if you have a device breach. Now, all the previous things, they were all possible as a regular user. So as I was researching this, I had some theoretical observations. And I thought, well, if you're an administrator, maybe you can steal the primary refresh token itself, as long as it's not stored in a hardware module. Because anything that's stored in the operating system, if you're an administrator, you can in theory access. And maybe there are even some techniques to interact with the primary refresh token, even if it's stored in the TPM. Or maybe you could register your own device, fake it as compliant, and get your own primary refresh token. And this is actually, all of three of these have been researched by now. So I can share a result of that. And first, looking at the primary refresh token as admin, there are some research I did in combination with Benjamin Delphi, who is the author of Mimikatz. And we basically built a combination of Mimikatz and RoTools in order to obtain and use the primary refresh token to dump it from LSS, just like you would dump credentials in an Active Directory environment. And that's done by the by the Cloud API module. So if you run Mimikatz with the Cloud API module, then you can actually dump the primary refresh token. And I have a demo of this later, so we'll show it later. But this is in case, so there's two important distinctions here. One is where the token is stored in the TPM, and one is where it's where there is no TPM, so the secret key for the primary refresh token is stored on disk. So if it's stored on disk, then it's easy because the key is in LSS, because LSS is using it actively, and if you dump the primary refresh token material using Mimikatz, then you can also extract the key that belongs to the primary refresh token. So then you can really steal the primary refresh token and go off somewhere else, and you can use the primary refresh token for at least 90 days. But if there is a TPM, then the actual secret that it stores in hardware, and you can't really extract that, because it's just put in there, and you can only say, okay, I want to sign something with the secret, but you can't say, okay, now give me the secret, please. And I wanted to look at this as well, because, well, I'm not really a TPM research person, but if we assume that the TPM is doing some unknown magic, then there's always the LSS process, which is interacting with that TPM. So it somehow has to tell the TPM, hey, I want to do something with this refresh token, and please help me with that, and it will then get something back. And that's what we'll use to do the single sign-on. So I was really researching how this works, and it turns out that what LSS does, it sends a certain value to the TPM called a context. And the context, it's really just a random string. So it sends a random string to the TPM, and the TPM will then basically sign that context using the secret that's related to the primary refresh token. And this is called a derived key. So you have the actual key, and you have the key that's derived from the actual key, which is called a derived key. And that's basically a combination of this random context value and some static strings. So LSS just sends a random value to the TPM, and the TPM gives a key back. And then LSS sends the context plus the primary refresh token plus a signature to Azure AD. And then Azure AD can verify whether that's all correct. And then you have your single sign-on process complete. But the thing is, as an attacker, we control everything that's happening in LSS, because that's all software. So if we are administrator user and we elevate to system, and we ignore any defensive measures, or we bypass them, and we can access the LSS memory, then we should be able to influence anything on the left. However, anything on the right in the TPM, that's stored in actual hardware, so you can't access that from software. But if you have the ability to send a context to the TPM, and the TPM will give you the correct key, then that's already something that you can use. And there's a flaw in this whole process, because it turns out that you don't actually need this whole key in the TPM, because eventually the derived key is what matters to in order to do your single sign-on. So I don't know how they were trying to implement this, but it turns out that with only this context, which is random, so you can generate your own, and with the derived key, you can already do the single sign-on. So if you obtain both of these once, then you can do single sign-on whenever you want. And if I just send a million contexts to the TPM, and I get a million different derived keys, then I can single sign-on a million times, which is, I think, going to give me access for quite a while. So this whole protected by TPM isn't exactly as solid as Microsoft probably thought it was when they designed it. And just to show this, I have another demo. And we go back to the virtual machines. And I need to sign in again. All right, so here I have Mimikatz installed. And this is, so for this attack, you do need administrative privileges. And this is also something that would be stopped by the ASR rules. But if you can bypass that, or you don't have the ASR rules, or you don't have an EDR that stops this stuff, then you can exploit this. So we give ourselves the debug privileges, which is required to access the memory of the LSS process. And then we dump the primary refresh token. And you see here, this is the the Cloud AP environment, and it says I'm Joe Biz. So this is all correct. And this is actually the primary refresh token. And I'm just going to note that down somewhere. And here's the what you see, the proof of possession key, which is the key that is used to prove that we actually have this primary refresh token. So it's the secrets that we need to actually use this primary refresh token. And we see that it's so the key type here is NGC, and it's a very long string. And basically this means that it starts in a TPM, because if it wasn't, it would be a much shorter one. And this is also what I can actually verify by running the DSREC CMD. There you will see that. So this is TPM protected. So I can't access the actual key that is part of the primary refresh token. But what I can do is I can ask the TPM to calculate a derived key for me that I can then use to do my own single sign-on. So I'm going to copy this value. And then I'm going to elevate my rights to system. So that's previously I was in a high privileged user context, and now I'm elevating to system, because you need that to actually to talk to the TPM, because an administrator user cannot do this. You need to be system. And then I can decrypt this key, and I just hope I remembered the things correctly. Right, so here I provide the encrypted data, and it says, well, this key type is TPM protected, and it can't decrypt this because it's stored in the TPM. But what it can do is it can calculate the context and then give the derived key, which is the key that's actually used to do the single sign-on. So I'm going to copy both. So the context goes here, and the derived key also goes here. And then I'm going to move to my attacker VM, and I'm going to remove the authentication information, and I'm going to give RoteRecon the primary refresh token that we dumped from LSS. changing this. It's a very long one. And I'm going to give it the context that Mimic has generated. And lastly, I'm going to give it the derived key that Mimic has calculated for us by asking the TPM nicely. And then it should sign me in. And as you see, it did. And I now have this these tokens again. And I can run the same data gathering command as before. And I actually did it by stealing the primary refresh token and by stealing a combination of context and derived key that I can use to authenticate. And actually something interesting with this is that Azure AD doesn't even check if the context is unique. So I can simply run this command again, and then I'm signing in again, and I can do the same tomorrow or the day after. And this context, it's just a random value, and this derived key is all that matters. So if you have a context and a derived key once, it doesn't really matter that you don't have the actual key, because the actual key is stored in hardware. But this this combination is good enough to use this primary refresh token for as long as it's valid.
Okay, can you stop this attack with the credential card, or is it not protected with the which you can block the Mimikatz thing? Is this also stoppable by enabling the credential card option for Microsoft, or?
I think that this one actually has credential cards enabled. Yes, so this VM has credential card enabled, and as you can see, it's not stopped by it.
Okay.
Nice. So I don't know why they didn't create credential guard for the cloud part, because it would seem to me that it's quite important to protect that as well. But credential guard is not it doesn't protect the cloud AP plugin. Okay. I imagine that's something they will be doing in the future, but as of now, it's not there.
Okay, thank you.
Let's see, I do have a few more slides. So the short version, if an attacker is admin on your laptop and that laptop has a primary refresh token, they can steal the primary refresh token itself if it's not in the TPM. And if it is stored in the TPM, the attacker can still acquire the required data to actually use the primary refresh token without having access to the device. And this is not covered by credential card. So there's not really a way to stop this without if an attacker has admin on your laptop, it's already too late. So the only way to stop this is by preventing attackers from getting access to your laptop in the first place and from getting admin on your laptop in the second place. Okay, the last topic, I promise it will be a quick one. Device compliancy. And this is also an interesting topic, because another researcher from Finland, he did some research on getting your own primary refresh token with a compliant, between quotes, device. Because in the end, registering a device is also a set of APIs. And if you have the correct credentials, then you can call these APIs and you can register your own compliant device. Or you could, at least you can register your own device. And then you can also try to make it compliant by talking to Intune. So this is part of the AAD internals PowerShell module. And with that, you can register a device. So this will prompt for authentication and MFA if that's needed. And then it will register a device using that. And the device will show up in Azure AD. provided that you are actually allowed to register a device, because this is something that you can restrict to certain users. But by default, anyone can register your own device. And if you have that device, then you can also obtain a primary refresh token. So to do that, you will need the plain text password of a user. But if you use the combination of the device certificate that you got by registering your device, and you use the username and password of the user, then you can actually get a primary refresh token and the key that's required to use it. And of course, since you registered this yourself, then the key is not going to be protected anywhere, because you can just save that on disk. And Azure AD thinks that it's Windows doing this, but in fact, it's just a PowerShell module. If you want to read more about this, then you can also read on the blog that I posted below about the details of this. And what you can actually also do using this, it's the same PowerShell module, you can also register your device to Intune once you have this device certificate. And then once again, that is subject to who you allow to enroll devices into Intune. So this only works if you allow anyone to register a device in Intune. If you locked it down to only pre-registered devices, for example, then this doesn't work. But if you allow people to register their own devices into Azure AD and into Intune, then they can just pretend to register a device, and then they can connect to Intune and just say for every compliancy setting, they say, well, yes, I met this requirement. And then Intune will say, well, you met all the requirements, so your device is now compliant. And then you can actually use this primary refresh token to have a compliant device. So this is kind of an upgrade. So registering a device does not require MFA by default. It's definitely something I recommend you enable. But if you don't enable that and you have all the other defaults enabled, which require people to register devices and to register them into Intune, then an attacker could upgrade their password-only access to compliant device access. And then they could meet policies that require compliant devices. And I often see that people use policies where either you need to use MFA or you need to use a compliant device. And if you allow people to get a compliant device without MFA, then that's kind of a bypass for this whole policy. This also works for hybrid devices, by the way. Anyone in Azure AD or anyone in on-prem Active Directory can register a new computer by default, which is also something I've never actually seen people disable, maybe once or twice, but almost never. And then you can also register that device in Azure AD. And because there is no specific policies for that, then it's much easier to comply with that. But it does require an attacker to already have access to on-prem AD and at least one account. So it's different requirements, but it might actually be easier. So a few tips for the blue side of things. I would worry about the other stuff first. This whole single sign-on problem is, in my opinion, more something that Microsoft has to look at and really mitigate in depth. We have not seen too many things in the news about this actually being abused. I think it's already probably being abused, considering that a lot of other things that we never heard about were also already being abused by actors in the wild. So this is not the first thing you should worry about, but for sensitive accounts, maybe you should be worrying about this. And it also means that defending the endpoint becomes more important, because if all the other settings in Azure are really locked down, then it becomes very important who can access your trusted endpoints and use the single sign-on to still get access to everything in Azure. It's also important to restrict who can join or register devices. If you lock that down really tightly, and if you're using Intune, then you can also said that you can only enroll corporate-owned devices, which you can do pre-registration with autopilot and all that kind of stuff. I'm sure there are people here who are much more familiar with that than me, but you can lock this down and prevent people from registering their own devices. And of course, require multi-factor authentication to register a device, because otherwise, depending on the policy, they might not need MFA to register a device, and they may be able to get a compliant device without actually having to enter MFA. If you do have monitoring capabilities, I would definitely monitor device joins. They shouldn't be happening too often for users. And if a sysadmin is suddenly joining a new device and they are not using any new device, then maybe that's something to be worried about. And especially for sensitive accounts, I would recommend that you set up multiple conditional access policies. So one that requires a compliant device and one that requires MFA for sensitive accounts. And the reason for that is requiring a compliant device only means, it actually means not your compliant device, but it means anyone's compliant device. So as long as I have access to one compliant device as an attacker or to one hybrid joined device, then I can meet this policy for any user where I have the username and password from, because that's just how this works. You don't necessarily need to have a primary refresh token on the device. You can also use different accounts, and if you use that on the same device, it will still pass these policies without you actually being the registered owner of that device. So I do hope that Microsoft will introduce something for that in the future, that they will actually make it possible to restrict users to devices they own. Because if you have 100,000 devices in your company, then it's not that hard to obtain one compliant or hybrid joined device for an attacker. Some closing thoughts. Broad condition access policies are the best ones. If you start doing it really fine-grained and you have one policy for each specific platform, but then you may not get full coverage, and there may be ways to bypass it. So make sure the policies that you have cover all possible scenarios. And remember that compliant or hybrid means anyone in your organization's compliant or hybrid device, and not necessarily your compliant device. So if you have a very strict policy for your admin account, and someone at HR opens a CV from an attacker, and somehow the attacker obtains your admin account credentials, they can still pass these policy which require only a hybrid or a compliant device. All right, that was a lot of content and a bit longer than I expected it would take. So thanks for listening, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Oh, thanks a lot. It was really interesting.
Are there still any questions, or is everyone like information overload mode now?
Digesting the information, I think.
Yeah, getting ready to start trying some things out.
Yes, it's an interesting world out there. And sure. I don't think that we're fully there yet with Azure AD security. But I hope giving a few years that many of these problems will be solved.
Yeah, I'm actually surprised about the context part that you described, and that it doesn't have some sort of timestamp in it like it does with Kerberos.
Yes. Yeah, I was also surprised by that. I would expect it, because with previously it was actually possible, because with the first demo I had to use a nonce and I had to give that to the victim machine, and only with that nonce I was able to do the single sign-on. That actually didn't used to be there. If you just requested single sign-on on the victim host and you didn't specify a nonce, it would just give you a cookie that was valid for 15 minutes, and it wasn't tied to any specific browser session. So after that they enforce the nonce. So you would have a nonce and you would need to pass that to the other device in order to do the single sign-on and prove that you're actually on that device. But they did not enforce, for example, the nonce to be passed down to the TPM so that the TPM would like sign the nonce and then really prove that you're actively have access to the TPM for that specific session. I'm not sure if that's something they will do in the future, but it's not there yet.
Well, I don't have any other questions, so thanks a lot.
Yeah, you're welcome. If there are people with questions, they can always reach out to me by Twitter or via email, firstname.lastname@foxit.com. And always happy to answer technical questions.
Cool. Yes, if there are no questions, they know how to reach you. Thank you, Dirk-Jan, for this interesting talk. We are motivated to make our conditional exit policies and all that kind of stuff better and better. So thank you very much for this session and eye-openers for some new things for me. And I have to investigate, I've asked the guests. So we think as an administrator that there also are flaws in the guest system. So I think there are also, if somebody is going to investigate it, I think you can find there also things. That's my my guest statement.
Well, if you have things that you think would be interesting for me to investigate, then you can always send me the details.
Yes, I think there's something to do there.
And I always, it's always good for me to also talk to people that actually work with this technology every day and the struggles that they have, because often I'm just in my lab environment and I can come up with my own things, but it's only if you look in the real environment and see what people do and why they do it that you really find things. Okay, so this thing a lot of people do, so is that safe or do they just assume that something is safe?
Yeah, we had another speaker maybe about a year ago and we still had on-premises events. His name was Sami Lyo, and he actually told me it's not a matter of that you are able to make your environment fully secure, but it's a matter of making your environment more secure than your neighbor at the moment. And that was actually his message there. And I think today you proved him correct again. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's back to the bike story.
Yeah, indeed.